So, François has gently reminded us and me that my competitive edge this morning is my age. It's a sobering thought. Now, I will speak about a theme which is the one of the demise of the Bretton Woods system explains much of our current financial vulnerabilities. It is my view, and a view that I hasten to say is not shared by the main consensus, that the dramatic financial evolutions that have unfolded over the last four decades or so, i.e. over-leveraged global economy, excessive reliance on easy money, very low interest rates, exacerbation of financial cycles, have a common origin, which is the demise of the Bretton Woods system. I have lived through the breakdown in 1971-73 of the post-war exchange rate system. While reflecting later on those events, it became clear to me that the abandonment of the Bretton Woods system was bound to have profound consequences that were not understood at the time and are still largely underestimated today. My remarks will be organized around two headings. Firstly, what has been the far-reaching consequences of the demise of the Bretton Woods system? And secondly, how can this explain the dramatic undercurrents and growing structural imbalances which we are saddled today? What could be done to restore a more normal international system? Now, the far-reaching consequences of the demise of the Bretton Woods system. This has entailed deep and far-reaching consequences for our societies. Indeed, one has to understand that the international monetary system created in 1944-45 was much more than a set of technical rules on exchange rates. It was, in fact, and foremost, a way of maintaining a common framework for monetary stability and a coordinated economic policy stance among the major players of the international system. If a member country decided to follow a policy at odds with the common understanding, for instance, by running large fiscal deficits or huge credit expansion in order to try and reach higher growth, the exchange rate of such a country came inevitably under pressure. Capital flights and inflation would weaken its balance of payments as well as its exchange rate, which would be pushed against the limit of 1% authorized fluctuation band. At the time, the country in question could not easily devalue. It had to request from the IMF the permission to do so. And under the fund conditionality, its economic and monetary policies had then to be adjusted so that the country could regain the common implicit anti-inflationary stance. The system did not allow free riders, nor the competitive and repetitive devaluations of the 30s, which had contributed to the run-up to the Second World War. It was precisely to avoid that common discipline that the United States on August 15, 1971, decided to put an end to the convertibility of the dollar in gold. They wanted to finance the Vietnam War through deficit spending and recover their freedom of maneuver, which was severely constrained by the Bretton Woods system, as well as by the limits of their gold reserves. The Triffin dilemma had to be surmounted. At the time, dollars held by foreign central banks were worth twice the value of US gold reserves. So the convertibility of the dollar in gold had become impossible. At the time, the economic profession was very much in favor of getting rid of the exchange rate stability system. The consensus, quote unquote, developed the famous theme called the trilemma. According to that view, a country could not pursue at the same time the three following objectives: the autonomy of its economic policy in order to maximize growth, the freedom of capital movements, which was supposed to be a major growth factor, and the fixity of the exchange rate. One element had to give. It was, of course, the exchange rate fixity. And it was added that a floating system had other virtues. It would help, through exchange rate depreciation, debtor countries to regain competitiveness, and it would also encourage, through currency appreciation, creditor countries to adjust. But in fact, the 1976 Jamaica Agreement, result of the international negotiations, was very different from the theoretical pattern of floating rates. The total freedom for countries to choose their exchange rate regime, principle that was enshrined in the new IMF Articles of Agreement, was misused. Creditor countries were afraid to lose their competitiveness if they allowed the market to drive up the appreciation of their exchange rate. Therefore, they intervened heavily by buying dollars to prevent such an appreciation. And the result was fourfold. Firstly, creditor countries accumulated huge reserves in dollars, thus expanding massively international liquidity. This has been a major source of international liquidity creation. Secondly, the U.S. could easily finance its structural deficits without having to suffer the impoverishment that would have been the inevitable consequence of a true floating system. Imported inflation through the dollar exchange rate depreciation was thus avoided. Thirdly, the economic policy coordination at the heart of the Bretton Woods system had disappeared. The expectations that had been anchored on a stable exchange rate system had been replaced by a non-system in which each country could intervene as it wished on the exchange rate market. And perhaps more importantly, fourthly, structural reforms could be postponed since it had been so easy, it was so easy to borrow under the new system. The name of the game since the early 80s became, I quote, borrow as much as you can and as much as you wish. You don't have to worry about the exchange rate. It's the market that will take care of that, end of quote. This non-system, I should say this anti-system, is having far-reaching consequences on our so-called multilateral system. It is eroding confidence in money. The more accumulation of indebtedness, the more uncertainty and less confidence, and we should draw our attention en passant to the huge increase of net buying of gold by central banks since a couple of years. The non-system allows, through monetary policy moves, nationalistic strategies for the external value of currencies, which is a root cause of trade distortions and beggar thy neighbor policies. So I come to my last point, which is the fragilities of our present system are largely the result of the demise of the Bretton Woods system. Many manifestations of, I would call it overborrowing, some others would call it borrowing, have been surging since then. Just a few examples: official reserves in US dollars jumped from 2% of GDP, world GDP, in 1969 to 10% in 2011, which is a multiplication by more than five in real terms in 40 years. Non-financial private credit more than doubled from 2000 to 2016, from 52 trillion to 105 trillion. This evolution towards more and more financial products and services was facilitated by deregulation that started in the 80s and by financial innovation. This resulted in huge leverage in the economy, accompanied by a growing fragility of the financial system. Lending institutions as well as borrowers get weaker and more subject to the vagaries of the credit cycle, where the amount of debt gets out of control, and a systemic postponement of structural reforms, since easy and cheap borrowed money was available. Now, just a few words to finish on the, in my view, mistaken consensuses that have flourished since the demise of Bretton Woods. I'll just take a few. Firstly, money creation and accommodative monetary policies are good for growth, says the consensus. I will not delve into a comprehensive analysis of the advantages or drawbacks of an accommodative monetary policy. This would be too contentious this morning. But I'll just state my point in one sentence. Observation shows that abundance of money eventually distorts and weakens the financial system more than it stimulates growth. It is now widely recognized that the cause of the 2007-08 crisis was the result of excessive debt encouraged by monetary policy. Asset bubbles are an unavoidable consequence of quantitative easing. Second consensus, low interest rates, even if they can be negative, are good for investment. And the good people in the street believe it. But as objective study shows, that extremely low interest rates for long periods do not foster investment. They encourage preference for liquidity, which is problematic in terms of investment. Keynes shows that interest rates should be basically in line with marginal return on capital and should not be, as he says, too low and below what he called a minimum acceptable rate. In spite of very accommodative monetary policies, investment growth, particularly in the European Union, has been lagging over the years, 1% on average from 2010 to 2017. Zero rates, by the way, reduced the risk signaling element of interest rates. Third consensus, high public debt is not a major problem. Empirical studies show, on the contrary, that beyond certain thresholds, which are about 80% of GDP, public debt is accompanied by significantly less growth than in less indebted countries or in countries that have decided to reduce their public debt. For sure, the Keynesian policies focusing on the need to stimulate domestic demand in cases of recession have been a major breakthrough in policy making. But one must understand that structural factors can and do reduce the efficiency of the multiplier effect. I'll just cite two of them. The effectiveness of the stimulus depends very much on the state of public finance when the stimulus starts. This is a new element of economic literature to which I have contributed. Secondly, labor rigidity and too little job mobility can also jeopardize fiscal stimulus policies. A stimulative policy in an open economy that has lost its competitiveness can lead to more imports than to increased local output. In a recent article, the Nobel laureate Edmund Phelps shows that the speed of economic recovery after the crisis was faster in Germany, Switzerland, the Netherlands, who used very little fiscal stimulus, than in Italy, France, Portugal, where stimulus was accompanied by low growth. Big deficits, as he says, did not speed up recovery. One of the reasons of this relatively inefficiency of fiscal stimulus is what Keynes called the lack of business confidence, and of dynamic investment, which are not determined by fiscal deficits. And then the fourth one is free capital movements are good for growth, isn't it obvious? Well, as Monsieur Villeroy de Gallo has just said, capital flows can be disruptive, feed bubbles, and destabilize the financial system. So, since the fall of Bretton Woods, a profound change has occurred. The international world has entered the era of a debt-driven economy. In other words, credit expansion has outpaced potential growth. Before the demise of Bretton Woods, credit and economic growth used to move more or less at the same pace. But since the end of the 70s, credit expansion has reached more than two times the average rate of economic growth. This has led to the oversizing and to the predominance of financial markets. Could we go back to Bretton Woods? That is the question for the future. I do not think personally that an identical return to Bretton Woods is possible, nor even perhaps desirable. Indeed, the system was too mechanistic and asymmetrical, since it penalized debtor countries and favored creditor countries. This being said, it would be highly desirable to stabilize intelligently the exchange rate system. And that is far from impossible. Mechanisms exist and could be used. A basket of major national currencies should be established, and an approved authority would see to it that the relationship between those currencies would be under close surveillance. The authority should also see to it that short-term disruptive capital movements should be reined in. In a much more ambitious perspective, one could think of reviving Keynes and Triffin's ideas and move towards a truly international monetary system. In such a system, the IMF would control and adjust the global supply of reserves, including private credit, and issue for external transactions an international currency in line with world trade needs and with low inflation. Gradually, this would bring an end to the present drawbacks of national currencies playing the exclusive role of being the international reserve of the world system. But such proposals require political vision, will, and leadership. And for the time being, nothing seems to be moving in that direction. The major players of the world economy, like the US, China, Japan, and some others, find the present non-system perfectly suitable. The Americans can live and grow while borrowing more and more. As for the net exporters, they accumulate dollars while taking advantage of the amount of economic growth stemming from their exports. And of course, financial operators are perfectly happy. They love it. In the framework of this fragile balance of national interest, I don't see for the moment any will to reform things in a multilateral way. The element of policy cooperation and of apparent reduction of national sovereignty, which is inherent to the restoration of any exchange rate stability mechanism, does not seem compatible with the present nationalistic policies of our world. In other words, governments believed that by abandoning Bretton Woods, they had at last recovered their freedom of choosing their policy mix. In fact, they have yielded their autonomy to the markets by borrowing massively. In the words of Edmund Phelps, which I cite again, I quote, "The fundamental problem of our time is the great Western slowdown for the last 50 years. The symptoms are weak investment, falling rates of return to investment, poor productivity gains, declining job satisfaction, and disappearance of what Phelps calls exhilarating growth, end of quote. And it is clear that these issues cannot be resolved, gentlemen central bankers, by monetary policy or even fiscal stimulus. The huge rise in government debt will require eventually increased taxes in the future, be it through inflation. The enormous rise in money creation and liquidity is inflating asset bubbles, destabilizing financial markets, hurting business confidence, and thus entrepreneurship, which is not good for economic growth. Thank you for your attention.